My name is Robert McCoy. I'm an architect, a Bachelor of Architecture from the University of California in Berkeley in 1963. Been licensed in California since about 1964. From about 1965 until about 1985, most of my experience has been in a high-rise, multi-story steel buildings. The first major high-rise building that I was involved with was the headquarters for Pacific Gas and Electric Company in San Francisco. It's a 34-story building, about 1,250,000 square feet in the high-rise portion, about the same time that that the World Trade Center was designed and built in New York. In fact, we corresponded with the Yamasaki's office at the time to discuss certain aspects of their building and ours. Both buildings were designed, for instance, to resist the impact of an airplane flying into them. While with that firm in San Francisco, Hertzke & Knowles, I also participated in the design of 575 Market Street, a building for Standard Oil, one of their headquarters buildings. It was 44 stories. 100 Pine Street, which is 34 stories. And following PG&E, I finished up the final design, redesign, and construction of the St. Mary's Hospital and Medical Center in San Francisco. Following that stint, I was in private practice for a period when William Pereira acquired my firm to give him a presence in San Francisco. He had a couple of high-rise buildings to do, one of which was One Sansom, which was initially designed as a 54-story building, subsequently reduced to about 44 stories when Citicorp came into the project. As those buildings were getting underway, I was needed in Los Angeles and relocated to Southern California, where I was the project director and chief operating officer for the joint venture for the design and construction of the Tom Bradley International Terminal at Los Angeles International Airport. That building is about 1 million square feet. It depends upon where you measure it, but it's a good solid five-story steel frame building. Given footprint on the departure level, for instance, is in excess of 3 football fields side by side. It's a pretty good size open-air steel frame building. Those buildings in New York have a very strong exterior skin. The columns are 3'4" on center, and they're about 14 inches wide. There's about a 42-inch spandrel at each floor of steel, so the net opening where the window is, by the time you discount the fireproofing and the rest of it, is, you know, 40 or 50% of the exterior skin. When those planes hit those buildings, they were shredded the moment they started into the building. Most of the fuel, most of the plane was torn apart as it went through the outside skin. I've seen photographs since that show that the columns and some of the beams were severed in the North Tower, which was, I guess, not surprising considering the force of the impact, the weight of the plane, and the speed. But the diagrams that I've seen shown that those planes were that everyone else has concluded the same thing I had. The planes were shredded. The fireball was on the outside. The impact, shredding the plane, will create enough heat to explode that fuel, and that fuel moving at 500, 550 miles an hour as it goes through, as whatever's left going through the building or on the outside is seeking oxygen to explode and burn. It was gone in moments after it hit the building. So in rethinking it, I discovered that there were others who had similar thoughts. And that's when I came across Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. Let's talk a little bit about the impact on the two towers. On the North Tower, the plane looks to me like it took out about 60 columns or so I read somewhere about 60% of the columns and some of the beams. But the building didn't deform and collapse. The nature of the steel frame for that exterior skin, the supporting the exterior wall of those buildings, is a truss. It's a solid truss. You've got columns at 3'4" on center, and you've got 42-inch deep or 48-inch deep spandrels, beams at 12-foot on center, and they're all welded together. They're put together in a group and erected in the building in tiers, three floors high, several bays wide. The buildings were solid. They lost columns, they lost beams, but the building didn't collapse. On the south tower, the building hit pretty well towards a corner and took out the columns in along one wall, and it began to cave in, and the building, as we saw in the videos, the top leaned over and began to twist, and then before it started down. Now we have the mass of that building from up above coming down in strong, you know, it's going to begin to impact the whole building as it comes, as everyone has described. But it's going to come down in a pancake fashion, in a staccato kind of a way, bang, 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 as it comes. It's not going to come as a smooth fall. You're going to see puffs of pulverizing concrete each time a floor hits, a series of floors hits another floor. I didn't see that. I saw billowing clouds of dust when I viewed the videos. Now keep in mind that the steel supporting this building in the middle is very strong. Those columns were probably four times as strong as they needed to be to support the dead weight above them. So now you have this building coming down in a staccato pancaking effect, or that's what we're led to believe, and the columns below just simply not there, not resisting it, not stopping it. And they came all the way to the ground. From what I understand, the buildings actually accelerated as they came down, meaning they were not getting resistance from these massive columns in the center of the core of this building. The core of this building was very heavy. True, it was a lot of holes, like mostly holes, mostly voids, but it had beams in all directions and it had columns on a fairly regular spacing, something on the order of magnitude of 33, 35 feet on center, some of them closer together than that. So it's accelerating as it's coming down. There's not meeting resistance from all of the columns, these massive columns inside the building. And when you get to the bottom of the building, they're huge columns, huge. Where were those columns? Why weren't they resisting and punching through the mass of the building coming down from above? Where were they? Let's go back again to the top of the building. Remember I mentioned that the top began to buckle over and twist. If this building were truly severely damaged at the floors where the plane went through and came down as an intact block above that, I would have expected that continuation, the twisting and the tipping, to have continued. I really would have expected the top section to have continued to veer off in the direction it was headed. It would have gone over the edge and started down top first. That didn't happen. So when we returned to Building 1, the first notice of failure appears to be the television antenna on top coming down into the building. It's coming down in the middle of the building where the building is mostly holes for elevators and duct shafts and pipe shafts and that sort of thing. There's nothing in the middle of the building to burn. How did that steel soften enough to allow the television mast to sink almost straight down into the building? And then the building began to collapse. Next, when we talk about Building 7, our building wasn't hit by a plane. We're told that there were fuel tanks to run emergency generators. The fuel wasn't a according to the NIST study, wasn't a contributing factor to the collapse. Their theory is office furnishings. Well, the photos don't seem to show that the building was burning in all over. The photos that I've seen seem to indicate that there were isolated fires scattered around the building,